18 episodes later, I finally returned to Tekken with Tekken 2. This was one of the games I got when we first got our original PS1 chipped. There was a list of games we could have, and both Tekken 2 and Tekken 3 were on it. I'd played my uncle's copy of Tekken 3 a bit already, so I wanted to see what this one was like. My dad wished I'd just asked for Tekken 3. Like the first game, I'll be covering the arcade version included in Tekken 5 first, then I'll follow it up with the PlayStation port. So at the end of the last game, Kazuya Mishima won the King of Iron Fist tournament and threw Heihachi off the same cliff dear old dad threw him off back when he was 5. He also seized control of Heihachi's company, the Mishima Zaibatsu. 2 years later, and it turns out our protagonist from the first game is just as much a monster as his dad is, possibly even more ruthless. He extorts money from smaller businesses, has his business rivals assassinated, and smuggles endangered species for genetic experiments. As he made the company the richest it has ever been, he also gained more and more enemies through his actions. He withdraws from the public into heavily guarded solitude, only talking to a mysterious stranger. Rumours begin to stir of Heihachi's survival, climbing back up the cliff he was thrown down. This prompts Kazuya to announce the King of Iron Fist Tournament 2, to attract all his enemies so he can crush them at once. So before we get back into the characters and see how they've changed these 2 years, it's time to go over the gameplay. Well, this time there's not much to say, which is good with how badly I explained the first game. It plays very similarly to the first game, but faster and more responsive. The gameplay hasn't gone full 3D, with only two characters having a sidestep. This game adds the 10 hit combos. You're not going to see any. Even if I was skilled enough to pull them off, I'd never get them off against this game's AI, but more on that in a bit. That's all, now for those characters. With Kazuya being the new boss of the game, Heihachi Mishima gets demoted and takes his place in the default roster. Heihachi did indeed survive being thrown down that cliff and climbed his way back up. He attributes his loss to spending his time indulging in his wealth instead of training, and trains alone with Kuma deep in the mountains, only coming out when learning of Kazuya's tournament. Heihachi maintains his Mishima Karate moveset, the Kazuya moveset with some borrowed Paul moves, just with some more moves added. It's always tricky in fighting games when the boss of the previous game is dethroned and returns as a regular character. Some just decline into either obscurity or mistreatment from the creators, but somehow Heihachi thrives from this. Heihachi is a very entertaining character, but I feel his turns as final boss are where he's at his least interesting. It's when he's gunning for power that he's at his best, not when he's at the top. I also like how, when pulling a twist swap of protagonist and antagonist, it's not actually Kazuya was the evil one and Heihachi was the good one all along. It's actually Kazuya is an arsehole and Heihachi is still an arsehole, but a different kind. As usual, I'll cover a character's first outfit in the arcade playthrough and their second when I talk about the PS1 part. Heihachi's first outfit combines his two outfits from the first game. It has the black colour scheme of his first Tekken 1 costume, but everything else is from the second. The ripped sleeves and the tiger head on the back. The gi may change colour by game, but it's a classic look for him and it always works. The ripped sleeves work so much better for him than the long-sleeved gi. But of course, Heihachi's design still isn't there yet. At 54 years old, he's still too young. Another change from the first game is that every character has their own stage. It's no longer a Mortal Kombat-style rotating stage list. In Heihachi's case, it's the Pagoda Temple. It's an alright stage. The most interesting thing about it is the hidden Easter egg. On the floor, Heihachi and Kazumi is carved into the floorboard, almost 2 decades before the name Kazumi Mishima became more than just trivia. Next, let's revisit Paul Phoenix. In the first tournament, Paul managed to defeat Kuma, setting up his true rivalry for life. However, he lost to Kazuya, where the fight did last for hours. During the 2 years since, he became a bouncer, which got him in a lot of fights. 2 years of street fighting to hone his skills, Paul is ready for the tournament, now believing himself to be the strongest in the world. The biggest addition to Paul this game is what is probably his most iconic move, the Burning Fist. It's an unblockable move that deals a full 100 damage, so most characters will be taken out in one hit. Of course, the issue is that it can't be cancelled once it starts and there's a lot of wind-up, so actually landing it is a challenge. But when it hits, it feels so good. Paul's Paul in this game. Aside from his new move, there isn't anything to say about him here, which is going to be a trend for a few returning characters in this game. He's still not comic relief yet, which I know a lot of people hate, and I agree that it can go too far in that direction, but I feel it adds more character to him. But this also extends to his costumes. They're both unchanged. His first costume is still his red gi. And I mean unchanged, there's no slight tweaks other than the higher polygon count. His stage is some offshore square near New York. I don't know why as a kid I thought this stage was on an oil rig. I guess the almost brown sky made me think of pollution. Now we move on to his best friend, Marshall Law. Last game, Law drew in a fight with Wang Jinrei, losing his chance at the prize money. However, Yoshimitsu's Tekken 1 ending was canon. Yoshimitsu stole money from the Mishima Zaibatsu and gave it to not just Law, but his entire poor neighbourhood. This money allowed Law to finally achieve his dream of opening his own dojo. However, his students were attacked and severely injured by Taekwondo practitioner Pector-san while Law was away. Peck defeated every single one of Law's students and trashed the dojo. Law learns Peck is entering the King of Iron Fist 2 and enters himself for revenge and to restore his dojo's reputation. Law plays pretty much the same as he did in the first game. Still a lot of fun, I always try getting those flip kicks even when it's a bad idea because I enjoy that move so much. Law's got more going on story-wise than Paul does. Giving him a rival martial arts teacher to face feels like a very natural decision now he has his own dojo. Hell, it's nice to see him have success, because normally, in fighting games, the person who needs the prize money the most is never the main character and thus has no chance of actually winning it. So I'm glad we were spared several games in a row of Law is still poor. His first outfit is a variant of one from the first game I never got to use. If you remember, his yellow jumpsuit in the first game changed completely from arcade to PS1, and I played through with both of those. This meant his simple shirtless with trousers and shoes costume went unused. This time it's his first costume and it's had some slight changes. He drops the wristbands and now wears a red sash instead of black. He has the same problem I have with the Mortal Kombat 1 Liu Kang costume. Yes, it's the most Bruce Lee faithful costume, but it's also his least interesting to look at. His stage is just him fighting near the Great Wall of China, not much to say about it. Next we have our first kind of new character, Jack 2. The first Jack was retired and to this day we still have no idea what happened to it. This is the next model, containing a new computer chip that allows them to learn from their mistakes. The Jack 2s were mass produced and used in germ warfare by the Russian military. On a mission, one Jack 2 finds an ill girl called Jane and rescues and escapes with her. The military try everything they can to track the rogue Jack 2 down and the girl, but they fail. This Jack 2 is entering to save his creator, Dr. Bosconovich, from the Mishima Zaibatsu. He wants to ask his creator to make him human like Jane. Jack 2 is a simple replacement for the original Jack, gameplay-wise. I like the trend of adding a new Jack each game, even if it does mean you could get attached to a certain Jack that will be gone by next game, thanks to each one's individual design and story. Jack 2 is up there in the pantheon of Jacks for me. His story with Jane alone makes him a more interesting character than the original Jack. Design-wise, he looks less awkward too. The original was almost comically top-heavy with little stick legs, and this one has more reasonable proportions. His first costume is quite similar to the original Jack's, with the camo trousers, boots and gloves, but goes for a plain black vest instead. It works. This Jack looks more human than the first, which makes sense considering his story. Despite being a Russian robot, his stage is Akihabara in Japan. I'm not sure why. Is that where Jack 2 fled with Jane? When developing his personality, did Jack 2 become an otaku? Fifth character we'll be looking at is Nina Williams. In the 2 years between the first and second tournaments, Nina and Anna's father, Richard, died. His last wish was for Nina to mend a broken relationship with her sister, however she simply couldn't go along with this. She's hired to enter the King of Iron Fist 2 to assassinate Kazuya, but she also has the ulterior motive of wanting to settle the feud between herself and her sister once and for all. Nina is still boring and I don't enjoy playing as her. Her first outfit is still better than her original first outfit, but the stockings and suspenders for taking part in a fighting tournament do look a bit ridiculous. I know she's supposed to be wearing a short dress, but the low poly count just makes it look like lingerie to me. Her stage is Athens in Greece, overlooking the Parthenon for some reason. There are still stages like Tekken 1 that are just real world locations, but when assigned to a specific character, some of them are just a bit questionable. But next is a character who is far from boring, it's King. In the first tournament, King took third place, failing to win the money he needed for his orphanage. But unlike Law, King didn't have a cyborg ninja pass by on a horse throwing money at him. He went back to funding his orphanage through his wrestling. However, the funds were beginning to run low and one of the children died in his care. King gave up his mask and ran away, causing Armor King to go looking for him. He eventually finds King drunk in an alley behind a bar. Armor King helps him get back on his feet and encourages him to train for the next tournament so that this time he can get that money for his kids. King's strings are still easy enough to pull off that I can smash the controller with my elbow and still get through the first few rounds of arcade mode. I always liked King's story in this game. Normally, when someone needs the prize money and they aren't the main character, the problem that requires them to win that money seems to freeze in place across every game where it's an issue. For example, Genfu's granddaughter was able to avoid dying across 3 games before he got the money to cure her. So I appreciate that they showed that there are consequences for those who needed the victory and aren't just there for personal grievances that can be solved outside of a tournament. King's first costume is a slight update to his original first costume. There's some slight colour tweaks, but the only addition is the gloves he's wearing. Another upgrade is that his torso actually looks like a torso now, instead of the massive scar tissue it was in the first game. His stage is the Church Sanctuary. Remember that King is also a Catholic priest as well as a wrestler, so it makes sense that once he hit his lowest point, he would turn to his religion. It also has one of the best music tracks in the game, both arcade and PS1 versions. Downbeat sounding, but not too much, and really catchy. Perfect for a guy trying to build himself back up after a fall. So next, let's check in on Yoshimitsu. After wrecking Ganryu in the first tournament and supplying Law's neighbourhood with stolen Mishima Zaibatsu money, Yoshimitsu tried raiding a laboratory containing the secrets of a perpetually powered engine. However, his sword arm was severed and he almost died, but he was saved by Dr. Bosconovich, the creator of Jack 2. Using the same technology Yoshimitsu was trying to steal, Bosconovich made him a perpetually powered cyborg arm to replace the one he lost. Sometime after, Bosconovich was captured by the Mishima Zaibatsu, so Yoshimitsu is entering the tournament to save him. Probably the most memorable new addition to Yoshimitsu this game, though I never used it while recording, is the Harakiri. He'll turn around and stab himself through the stomach, catching the opponent too if they're close enough. This is the game where Yoshimitsu really starts coming into his own. The cyborg arm is the first step to his character becoming his true, finished self next game. His first outfit is a big improvement over his more forgettable original design. I especially like the cone hat. This is around the middle for me in terms of Yoshimitsu costumes. There are some later ones that are much better, but as the series takes him in a more weird direction, some of his costumes just get a bit too out there for my tastes. So I like this costume more than his Tekken 1 costumes and his later out there ones. His stage is the Serene Forest. It's fine, he's going to have more forest stages in the future. Next up is the last returning fighter in the default cast, Michelle Chang. So remember that pendant Michelle's father was killed over, prompting her to enter the first tournament? Now Michelle's mother has been kidnapped by the Zaibatsu to force Michelle's participation in the second. She has no choice if she wants to save her mother. Michelle is pretty much the same as in the first game, plays the same story, even the same first outfit with no changes. I mean, first game she enters because a parent was attacked over a pendant, second game she enters because a parent was attacked over a pendant. I can sort of see why Michelle was abandoned from the canon story after this game, there's just not a lot to her. But at least she's not as aggressively boring as Nina. Her stage is the Arizona desert, and like everything else about Michelle in this game, there's not much to it. Next we have one of the default cast new characters, and just behind Heihachi in terms of importance in this game, June Kazama. June is an officer working for a wildlife protection organization. She's charged to arrest Kazuya due to his illegal activities in smuggling animals for genetic experiments. But there's also more to her than that. Originally being brought up in nature, she could communicate with it, but years living in Tokyo made her lose that ability. Then one night she was visited by her dead father's spirit and learned to understand the paranormal. She's not just entering the tournament to arrest Kazuya, but to free him of his evil power. June's a tricky character to play as, best used defensively. Many of her attacks have a long startup, making her vulnerable. Once you get her strings going, they deal a lot of damage. But because I'm bad, what I tended to rely on are a single string, the whiplash double lift upper, as it deals a lot when it connects. Then there's her spinning low kick. It's always a shame when you can't just play very well as a character you like. And I do like June. I think having an actual heroic character when the main character and main villain are both monsters is important. You need someone to root for. But for what makes June interesting, it's the fact that despite being the hero of the game, she's not some completely all good, flawlessly pure type. She's just as fallible as the rest. In the end, she did such a bad job arresting Kazuya that she fucked him instead. And her moment of weakness, which started with the best of intentions, is going to screw over a lot of people's lives in the future. But at the same time, her closeness with Kazuya is what ends up allowing him to be defeated in the end anyway. If Kazuya is inspired by Vegeta from Dragon Ball, then what happens between Kazuya and Jun is essentially how the Vegeta-Bulma relationship would go down in a world that takes itself a little more seriously. Just a little. For now. However, it is a huge pain that they've been playing the mysterious absence with June for 5 canon games in a row now. If you have no intention of bringing her back, just say she's dead. If not, stop dragging it out, it's been nearly 25 years. Who knows, it looks like the Jean Kazuya feud is going to be the main plot point of Tekken 8, so maybe June's canon return is imminent? June's first outfit is one I always forget about in favour of the second, mainly because the second is on the box in the PS1 intro. It's okay, it fits the theme of someone who was brought up in nature. Her stage is the Morning Fields. You can see Stonehenge in the background, so I'm not sure why June's stage is in England, nothing about her ties her to the country. Our final default character and second newcomer is Lei Wulong. A cop from Hong Kong, Lei's colleague was investigating a money laundering operation that had ties to the Mishima Zaibatsu. Said colleague was on a flight with a mafia accountant ready to deliver important documents to Kazuya, but the flight went down and killed them both. The The trail left behind by Lei's partner has him entering the tournament to investigate and to retrieve Bruce Irving, the only survivor of that plane crash. Despite my difficulty with the more technical characters, I somehow did very well as Lei. He's a character I do well with against the AI in this game, Tekken 3, and maybe Tag if I remember right. But as the series went on and he became more complex, I found myself struggling to use him more and more. Many of attacks put him in a different position, such as with his back facing the opponent or playing dead on the floor, all of which alter his moves. With how many Bruce Lee tributes there are in fighting games, I'm surprised at how few Jackie Chan tributes there are. Off the top of my head, I only know of Lei and Hon Fu from Fatal Fury. Lei is the best one, I'd say. Not so much in this game, but in later games they really nail the physical comedy aspect of Jackie Chan in Lei's endings and the like. And making him a cop makes perfect sense, as those tend to be Chan's most famous roles. The character is always a lot of fun, and I was absolutely dumbfounded when he missed the base roster for the first time in Tekken 7. Now that was an absence that just felt wrong until his return. His first outfit is a blue Changshan, which is fine, it's just that later games will improve his look a lot, so this version of it is my least favourite. His stage is the Hong Kong rooftop. I've never lived in a city, and I'm rarely on roofs. How many rooftops have yin-yang symbols and checkerboards painted on? Now that's the default cast. Like the first game, every character has their own sub-boss before taking on the final boss, but this time you didn't need to wait for a console port to play as them. Since this is being played as an extra on Tekken 5, all of them are available from the start. I'll begin with Lee Chao Lan. Since Kazuya and Heihachi swapped places, Lee is Heihachi's sub-boss. Lee was defeated by Kazuya in the first tournament, and when Kazuya took over the company, Lee, who didn't want to lose his position in the company, was reduced to a secretary out of spite. He spends the next 2 years miserable until Wang Jinrei offers to train him and encourages him to help Wang work against Kazuya and restore the company to its glory days back when it was controlled by Heihachi's father. Lee is Heihachi's sub-boss, as Heihachi sees Lee still being in the company under Kazuya's rule as a betrayal. Lee is still the most fun character in the game for the same reason he was in the first game. He's just law, but better. His down force ring still destroys the AI and gave me my quickest arcade playthrough, which was very satisfying with how difficult the AI is with this game. I really wish I played this character regularly as a kid. My appreciation for this guy grows with every game. His first costume is another update to his first costume from the first game, just a different vest, but the same colour. His stage is a shuttle's launch pad. I should bring up that sub-bosses don't get their own theme music. In arcade mode, they all share a theme, but outside of it, the sub-boss's stages just get Tekken 1 music. In Lee's case, he gets the Chicago theme. Next is Kuma, who returns as Paul's sub-boss once again. Kuma was defeated by Paul in the first tournament and was surprised to find there was another human as strong as Heihachi. When Heihachi went into seclusion to train for his return, Kuma joined him. He travels to the tournament with Heihachi, determined to get back at Paul for his defeat. Kuma has changed very little. He's still a Jack clone with a few extra bits of his own. That being said, I always appreciate Kuma's presence. The only real notable change with him in this game is that now he actually has a decent model. He doesn't look like shit anymore. His stage is just called Hills. Those sure are hills. The Tekken Wiki says this stage is in Greece. I don't know if it's true, but okay. Maybe it's because this stage uses Tekken 1's Acropolis theme? Next up is Law's sub-boss, the next new character, Peck Tosan. Peck's father was a Taekwondo champion who suffered a career-ending injury and became an alcoholic. He spiralled out of control and wound up in prison. And while his father was in prison, his mother abandoned the family. His father escaped from prison to try and help his children. However, this led to Peck mistakenly attacking his severely malnourished father and killing him. This fucked him up pretty bad. He was taken into care and raised by the police who found him. As he grew up, he became a master of Taekwondo just like his dad, but one day he was blackmailed by someone knowing the circumstances of his father's death. Peck is made to trash Martial Law's dojo under threat of the knowledge that Peck killed his own father will be made public. And in going along with this blackmail, he made an enemy of Law. Peck is a lot of fun in this game. He feels very quick and I just love a lot of his kick strings, especially the one that launches the opponent into the air. He's one I did quite well with. Being the game in half an hour sounds shit, but when dealing with the arcade version's AI, it's a lot faster than the majority of my arcade playthroughs. What I like about Peck is that when you first hear of him through Law's story, he sounds like a massive arsehole. Then you get his side of it and he's just the most downtrodden character in the game. Peck's life throughout the series is just a string of misery. You could say story-wise he's almost Tekken's equivalent to Reptile from Mortal Kombat, and that's not something I thought I'd say when I began writing this script. But yeah, I like him. Maybe even, controversially enough, more than his replacement going forward. He's a minor character, but he's not in every game, so you don't have the chance to get sick of him. His first outfit is very obvious for a Taekwondo practitioner, a Dobok. It fits him, but I bet his normal outfit being so basic is why he's not a massively popular character. His replacement has one too, but he also had a second outfit that stands out much more than Peck's. His stage is a Korean tempo. He stands out more than some other stages in the game. Peck actually has his own theme music instead of reusing a Tekken 1 theme. I bet this is because in some territories, the game is set so that Peck and Jun swap places, so Peck is default and Jun is a sub-boss. But back to a returning sub-boss with Prototype Jack, who's had a total makeover since the first game. That's because he was almost completely destroyed by the original Jack in the first tournament. When retrieved and reactivated, P-Jack constantly complained about his rival's upgrades until he'd run out of fuel. Months later, after being reactivated again, he complained some more until Kazuya made the captured Dr. Boskonovich work on upgrading him. But Boskonovich could only do so much. He gave P-Jack a hat and sunglasses and tricked him into thinking they were amazing protection against anything other Jacks could throw at him. He then enters a second tournament hoping for revenge. The wording of this makes me wonder if the Jack 2 on the roster is the same Jack from Tekken 1, just remodeled and containing the same memories. Or if P-Jack is just ready to destroy any Jack he can and doesn't care. His main new move is the ability to fly and try to crush the opponent beneath his feet. I've said before that Prototype Jack is my favourite Jack, and this is why. He gets a much better redesign. If Jack's appearance was inspired by a Terminator, then P-Jack now gets to be the Terminator skeleton. But he's also just really funny. I love that everyone around him just doesn't care and puts up with him. Like, he wants to be upgraded so he doesn't get destroyed again, so they just put a hat and sunglasses on him and blow off his concerns. Plus, there's attachment of him being the very first secret character I unlocked in a Tekken game when I first played this game's PS1 port as a 7-year-old. Sadly, this is Prototype Jack's last canonical appearance, as Jack 2 destroys him for good during the tournament. But we've not seen the last of him yet. His stage is the ruins of London. Yeah, London was canonically reduced to a wasteland by 1996 with just the ruins of Big Ben remaining in Tekken's universe. The fuck happened there? 26 years later and we still don't know who did that. He has Tekken 1's Windermere theme. Next, let's look at Anna Williams again. I've already explained the stuff between her and Nina already, so we don't need to go there. Other than say that events in their feud include Nina trying to rig Anna's car with a bomb and Anna machine gunning Nina's bedroom in response. That's actually kind of letting her off lightly. Fittingly enough, while Nina was hired to assassinate Kazuya, Anna was hired to be one of his bodyguards. That one actually was a coincidence. My feelings on Anna are still the same as they were for the first game. She's more fun than Nina thanks to having Lord's backflip kick, and she still has far more charisma than Nina has ever had. Anna's default costume is the same as in the first game, but like Kuma, it's much improved. The side of her dress is still stapled onto her leg, but at least it actually looks like a dress now and not a very puffy trouser leg. Also, her hair's still blue for some reason. Her stage is the Taj Mahal for some reason, now that I really don't get. It gets the King George Island theme from Tekken 1. Next is good old Armor King, still my favourite character at this point in time since my current favourite doesn't exist yet. After the first tournament he disappeared from the professional circuit and did his wrestling underground. That is until he found out about King's depression, so he works to help King get going again. I don't know if it's true, but Armor King's clone moves feel faster than King's. I look at his punch strings and they just look faster to me. He's still a lot of fun. I like this role for Armor King, helping to get a former rival out of a low point. He's basically Apollo Creed in Rocky 3. More thought went into him than Kuma or Michelle, I'd say. His default outfit is the same as it is in the first game. That's fine, because it didn't need changing or fixing. His stage, Nowhere Desert on the other hand, is quite bland for a character as cool as Armor King. And to add insult to injury, he gets the dullest stage theme from Tekken 1, Monument Valley's theme. From a character that was always good, to one that needed a glow up and got it, Kunimitsu, now Yoshimitsu's sub-boss instead of Michelle's. We don't know who defeated her in the first tournament, but she felt humiliated. She spends time with her grandfather, a famous swordsmith. He tells her about Yoshimitsu's sword, also called Yoshimitsu. It has the power to destroy a person spiritually and mentally. Whenever a new leader of the Manji Party is elected, the old leader is sacrificed with the sword, and the sword's power transfers to the next leader. Her grandfather tried his entire life to forge a sword as great as Yoshimitsu, but never could. Kunimitsu enters the King of Iron Fist 2 to face Yoshimitsu and steal that sword so her grandfather can finally forge a copy before he dies. Kunimitsu isn't a total afterthought in this game. She still shares many of Yoshimitsu's moves, but she actually has stuff of her own instead of moves taken away and nothing to replace them. She now wields a single kunai instead of the two kunais or two sickles from the first game. The other big change is that Kunimitsu is actually a woman now. She was referred to as a man in the first game and had Yoshimitsu's voice. Now she doesn't look like him, doesn't sound like him, and isn't even the same gender, so she can finally have her own identity. So her first outfit is a big improvement over what came before. The Kitsune mask is far more memorable than just copying the Oni mask Yoshimitsu wore in the first game. She keeps the purple colour scheme but loses the sleeves and gains an extra layer over her torso. Still not my favourite Kunimitsu design, but a million times better than her original design. I should also point out that last time I did say that I didn't expect Kunimitsu to make a return in Tekken 7, only for her to be announced a few months later. Granted that it's not this Kunimitsu, but it's still that identity on a playable character. All I'll say is, I'm glad to be wrong, but Namco really are terrified of women over 25, but are fine having Heihachi's 70-something year old ass cheeks on screen. Her stage is some Cambodian wetlands, just some grass and a lake. She gets Tekken 1's Angkor Wat theme. Ganryu is next, now Michelle's sub-boss, we'll get into why in a bit. In the first tournament, Ganryu was defeated by Yoshimitsu, a former fan disillusioned by the shame he brought to Sumo through his bad behaviour. But more importantly, Ganryu met Michelle, who he instantly fell in love with. When Kazuya took over the Mishima Zaibatsu, he recognised Ganryu's skill and hired him to be another of his bodyguards, paying him enough so that Ganryu can continue to feed his gambling addiction. He enters the second tournament as Kazuya's bodyguard, but he has an ulterior motive. He wants to build his own sumo ring, hoping it would help him woo Michelle, who has shown no interest in sumo ever. Ganryu is still fun as ever. His stepping palm is very useful in this game, as even if the AI continue to block it, they also don't know how to deal with it. So winning one round and then endlessly palming the second until I time out to a draw was a good way to make it through the mode. So this is the game where Ganryu's love for the women of the Chang family is introduced. It should make him look like a total creep, and in one instance it gets close, but I like how the series keeps him very innocent about it. There's no gross lusting over a clearly uncomfortable woman or any of that. He's like a kid trying to think of ways to impress his secret crush. And his constant failures are funny. But the thing that amuses me most regarding this subplot is a little thing in Street Fighter Cross Tekken of all things, a game Ganryu isn't even in. I don't know if people know what I'm talking about, but I hope it makes its way into the main series. His outfit is exactly the same as it was in the first game, a purple mawashi. I'd say Ganryu probably has the worst model in this game. It's not bad, like Tekken 1 Kuma, but to me he does look much blockier than everyone else. His stage is Kyoto at sunset. I like this one. It gives me vibes of Suzaku Castle from Street Fighter 2. Fittingly, he also gets the Tekken 1 Kyoto theme. Our last returning sub-boss is Wang Jinrei, now Jun's sub-boss. As said last time, Wang was a close friend of Heihachi's father, Jinpachi. After watching the Mishima Zaibatsu's decline in morality under Heihachi, and then its even further nosedive under Kazuya, Wang has had enough and wants to bring Honor back to his old friend's company. He starts by encouraging Lee to secretly work against Kazuya. He then enters the tournament to scope out potential fighters that could finish Kazuya. This is why he's Jun's rival, as Wang believes she's the one who could do it. He's gonna be disappointed, although he is prepared to step in and take on Kazuya himself if no one else can be found. In the first game, Wang was a Michelle clone with some moves taken from Nina and Paul. He's been differentiated from Michelle a bit and he's a lot more fun for it. For one thing, he feels faster than Michelle, and that we'd expect for a man in his 80s. Design-wise, he actually looks like himself now. I don't know who that guy was in the first game claiming to be him, but we can forget that guy now. His outfit is a similar style to what he wore in the first game, but with different colours. He also got rid of leg warmers and has a dragon design on his back. His stage is Szechuan Fields. Szechuan was a stage in the first game too, but had a different JPEG as its background. As you'd expect, he also got the first game Szechuan theme. And now the final sub-boss, Lays. It's newcomer Bruce Irving. Bruce grew up in poverty, losing both his parents and his brother as a child. Growing up around violence hardened him as a fighter and fueled his motivation to make a good life for himself. As an adult, he travelled to Thailand to take part in the Muay Thai Championship, and he did so well that he injured the current champion severely enough to end his career. A Muay Thai gambling organisation didn't like losing this fighter, so they hired a hitman to kill Bruce. Said hitman was also the guy delivering documents to Kazuya on the plane with Lay's police colleague. A fight broke out between the three of them and the plane went down, with Bruce as the only survivor. Wandering around the region they crashed, some sources say he resorted to cannibalism to survive, others not. He's found by the Mishima Zaibatsu and he befriended Kazuya, becoming a mercenary for him. Bruce is very fast, making him ideal for me to play as. Lots of quick kicks and elbow strikes. That dashing kick is especially good against the AI. I'm surprised I did as well as I did, because I never play as Bruce. Every game, I use him once to unlock his ending, and that's it. Part of the reason is that I always forget Bruce even exists. Of the 25 characters in this game, Bruce is the one I'll remember last if I had to name them all. I don't dislike him, I just feel apathy. I like him more than Nina, I think. His default outfit doesn't help either. Yes, it makes sense for a Muay Thai practitioner, but there's not much character to it. I still think Sagat pulls off that look the best. His stage is also not very interesting, a JPEG of the Grand Canyon. He gets the Tekken 1 Marine Stadium theme. But before we get to Kazuya, we have an actual secret character to talk about. If you win the last round of Stage 3 in Arcade with a great, basically a hit from death, you'll face Roger. I remember when I first discovered Roger as a kid, I had no idea why he appeared or what I did to cause it. He also acts as Kazuya's sub-boss. Remember those animals Kazuya had smuggled for genetic experiments? This is one of them. He really wanted the kangaroo that could box. Roger mainly takes from King, but also has a windmill punch with animation taken from Jack, along with some of his own things to fit his kangaroo body. While a lot of people accept Kuma, some see Roger as a step too far. Not me, I love Roger. I mean, kangaroos can be vicious bastards if you rocked up to one in real life and punched it in the face, so it makes sense to choose one of those if you want to modify an animal for martial arts. What is a pain though is that Roger's design was perfected after he was retired and replaced. I'd love to see Roger return playable with his Tekken 5 and Tekken 6 design. His stage is a beach with Tekken 1 Fiji's theme. Normally I don't associate the first game's recycled music with the sub-boss they were assigned to, but the Fiji theme has always been Roger's theme in my mind. However, instead of a different costume, selecting Roger with the kick button has you play as a different character, Alex. The Mishima Zaibatsu's animal engineering goes beyond living animals, as they even use dinosaur DNA to create Alex. Since he shares Roger's character slot, he's more of a costume than his own character, with no gameplay differences, but I'm doing a playthrough with him anyway. I like Alex even more than Roger. I mean, dinosaurs can be vicious bastards if you rocked up to one in real life and punched it in the face, so it makes sense to choose one of those if you want to modify an animal for martial arts. Alex's return in Tag 2 was one of the ones that made me happiest. That was a character I was certain would be doomed to obscurity. Roger and Alex are sub-bosses of each other, and Alex just gets Kuma's stage with the Fiji theme. After facing 7 other characters and a sub-boss, you finally take on Kazuya Mishima. I've pretty much already explained what Kazuya's been up to at the beginning of the video. Taking over the company, animal smuggling, extortion, assassinations. What I didn't mention is that he's also taken over most of Hokkaido to try and build an independent nation with a strong military force. Kazuya once again plays like he did in the first game, but being the boss, he's so much stronger in every way. This of course makes him a lot of fun in this game. Maybe it's because I played Tekken 2 long before I played any game with Heihachi as the boss, but I've always liked Boss Kazuya more than Boss Heihachi. He's also the perfect follow-up to Heihachi, not just as boss of the game, but as CEO of the Mishima Zaibatsu. Who better to be the boss of the second game than the guy who canonically won the first game? But as CEO, we go from a loud, boisterous guy who loves the fame and making public appearances, to one who shies away from the limelight and secretly runs things from the shadows. Kazuya's first outfit is his first outfit from Tekken 1, but with the fingers on the gloves and the belt fully black. I'll get into his second outfit on PS1, but let's talk about his third outfit, the one he wears when fought at the end of Arcade Mode. The purple suit is my favourite Kazuya outfit. Different games that include it have the coat at a different length, but that's not the part I care about, as long as it's purple. I wish he took over from his default as his main costume, I like it that much more. When playing as Kazuya in Smash Ultimate, I always use this costume. Oh yeah, bit of a tangent, but between my Tekken 1 and Tekken 2 videos, Kazuya got into Smash, didn't he? I certainly didn't see that coming. That was a pleasant surprise. It was funny seeing the contrarians who didn't know about Tekken but still had the strongest feelings about which character it should have been come out of the woodwork. Especially people who tried to call fucking Kazuya a Shoto. No, Yoshimitsu shouldn't have been the first Tekken character. This is a trend I always see, and it drives me up the wall. The mentality of, don't include the character people are actually asking for, include a mascot so that people don't get upset their favourite wasn't chosen over the most popular. We saw this all the time with people saying a Final Fantasy character should be Chocobo over Cloud. Sorry your favourite isn't the most popular, but get over it. People were like this with Terry too. They knew nothing about SNK, but just knew that their most popular character shouldn't have been the choice. I think some Smash speculators really pride themselves on their knowledge of games, but they sheltered themselves into a first-party Nintendo and similar games bubble, so when a character they don't know about gets in, they take it as a threat to their gamer cred. Where's your sense of discovery? I didn't know a good chunk of the Melee roster when I first played that, but I didn't get angry, I got curious. But anyway, Kazuya's stage. Eternal Darkness is a pretty cool one. It's just a floor and a black background, but it's a cool floor, and the pitch black background fits the guy who's hidden himself away and works from the shadows. Can't forget the music either. It's probably the most loved Tekken 2 track, and for a good reason. Don't know if it's my favourite too, but it's up there. Kazuya has Roger as his sub-boss for some reason, but instead of a mirror match for Stage 9, he faces Heihachi. But then you defeat Kazuya, and you aren't done yet. He rises again as Devil for another fight. When Kazuya was thrown off the mountain at 5 years old, the Devil came to Kazuya and offered him the power to overthrow Heihachi in exchange for his soul. Being pretty pissed at being 5 and thrown off a cliff, Kazuya takes that offer and uses that power to defeat Heihachi in the first game. When Kazuya is backed into a corner from a strong opponent, then Devil takes control of his body and does the fighting. There's more to the relationship between Kazuya and Devil, but that's all revealed in later games. He has Kazuya's moveset but with some additions, namely his lasers. One while standing, and another that has him fly through the air and sweep it along the ground. The laser sound effect is probably the one sound effect from this series I remember the most. You don't even need to see it hit to know it's going to be painful, you just have to hear it. I like two stage bosses in fighting games, and Devil is up there as one of my favourites. You don't even need to put that much effort in to make Devil seem worthy as a final boss. It's the Devil. Definitely one of the series' best bosses. Don't know if he's my absolute favourite, but I like him more than the elderly Heihachi with his ass cheeks flapping in the wind, or the Zodiac Chicken. His appearance, I feel, could have only worked back then. In blocky PS1 style, I think it looks great. When he gets another go with this design but a higher poly count, I'm not sure it looks as great. I think redesigning him but keeping the purple when the series became HD was a good choice. His stage, Mirror Darkness, is simple but effective, with the screen repeating itself into infinity. My only nitpick is that I'm not a fan of the fight and KO text appearing in the mirrors too. I think it lowers the atmosphere a bit. Not by much, but still a bit. Devil doesn't get his own theme until the PS1, so he keeps Kazuya's. What I like about this is that when you defeat Kazuya, the music doesn't reset. It keeps playing over the loading screen and continues into the Devil fight. It's a little thing, but I really like it. Devil's sub-boss is Heihachi, but instead of Kazuya at stage 9, he fights Jun. This makes sense, as Jun, being the one who has Kazuya's child, is the one causing conflict inside Kazuya, which makes Jun the biggest threat to Devil. For the final boss, Devil will instead face another character, Angel. Angel is selected by picking Devil with a kick button, like how Alex is to Roger. You can tell Angel is a last minute addition, as in the arcade version she doesn't have her own name yet, she's still just called Devil. Angel's role has always been murky. Originally it was thought that Angel was created as Kazuya's good side, trying to free him from the Devil. I don't know where it came from or if it's bad localization or just misinformation, but the current story is that Angel is a separate being feuding with the Devil over Kazuya's fate. Considering the Devil will keep making appearances, and this game is Angel's only canonical appearance, we can guess it didn't go well for her. She's just a costume for Devil, so I don't have to go into gameplay. I think Angel is a cool bonus, something that could only have been done back then. Hey, what if we made Devil's second costume a new character? What's the opposite of Devil? Angel, let's put that in. It certainly surprised me when I first unlocked Devil as a kid, chosen with the X button, and was suddenly Angel. I will say that her design is just okay, nothing special. Her returning tag too was a big improvement. Now that was a return I was not expecting. Not as unexpected as Miharu or Violet, but I never thought we'd see Angel again. I miss characters like Angel, with little bonuses like that. She wouldn't happen today, a victim of the increasing costs of game development. Even if they tried, some marketing department dickhead would try either calling offers on this pre-order DLC, or otherwise make us pay extra for what used to be a free bonus. But enough of that, time to complete 25 arcade playthroughs. Devil's AI is a total bastard, so there were many playthroughs where I'd get to him in 10 minutes, then spend more than half an hour fighting Devil alone. Sadly, on arcade, there isn't much time to let the victory sink in, as it boots you to the credits at breakneck speed. Yep, that's 100 games completed, but I'll talk about that at the end of the video. No endings, just a series of replays of you taking out everyone set to a medley of Tekken 1 songs. So there was the arcade version of Tekken 2, a big improvement over Tekken 1, but we're not done yet, we still have the PS1 port. First of all, like the first game, the PS1 adds a new FMV intro. This one is much better. We have actual hints of the story, with Heihachi climbing up the cliff, Michelle finding her home wrecked and mother missing, Yoshimitsu getting his new arm, Jack 2 finding Jane, the Drunken King having Armor King throw him his mask. Then there's a bit at the end that rapidly flashes the unlockable characters at you, all set to Black Winter Night Sky, one of the series' best intro themes. The CG is much improved, but not perfect. There's still some uncanny stuff. Nina's cheese string hair comes to mind. Before I get back to covering the roster's second costumes, this game added so much more to do than the first game's PS1 part. Team Battle. Pick a team of up to 8 characters and see which player loses all their characters first. I used to love messing around with this as a kid. A survival mod was added, along with practice. When you pause, you can check out a character's move list, which was invaluable to me as a child. Also other extras. Holding the select button when choosing your characters lets you play as them in big head mode. Keep holding it into the next fight and they get bigger. Hold L1 and L2 to activate wireframe mode, where you find the first person view like it's the arcade Punch-Out. They even included a helpful minimap so you can tell your distance from your opponent. The soundtrack was also redone. It's a tough choice between which I prefer. The only tracks I can say I definitely prefer in one version are the PS1's character select theme, so much better than the arcade version. But the track that plays over the CG gurning Heihachi face into title screen movie sounds awful on PS1. Devil also gets his own theme, a more somber arrangement of Kazuya's theme. I like it quite a bit, but it's not my favourite boss theme. Now to play through the game again. We only start with the default 10 characters, with the sub-bosses unlocked by beating the game to unlock that character's sub-boss. So I'll take this chance to talk about every character's second costume. Heihachi gets a costume that's going to become a regular for him going forward. A hakama with getter sandals and a loose kimono top. This also shows a scar on his chest he got from the fight with Kazuya. This is fine, but the least interesting version of it, as later games will add extra details to it to make it stand out more. Paul's second costume is the same leather biker clothes he has in the first game with no changes. Law gets another yellow jumpsuit, but it's not either of the ones he wore in the arcade or PS1 versions of the first game. This one has no sleeves and he wears a black shirt underneath. This one is my least favourite of his jumpsuits, I think. There's just not as much going on. I still like it more than his default costume though. Now, Jack 2's alternate costume I like a lot, more than his default even. It's this exoskeleton with steel hand wraps. I just think this looks so much cooler and the arms make me think of Mortal Kombat 3 Jacks. Nina has a green camouflage suit. Of the 4 costumes we've seen from Nina so far, this is my favourite. King gets the same alternate costume he had in the first game, a normal shirt and trousers with suspenders and a tie. I still love seeing King in casual clothes with the mask still on. Those are always my favourite outfits for him. Yoshimitsu's on the other hand doesn't do anything for me. It just reminds me of his costume from the first game, which I also didn't care for, but bulkier. One of his weaker costumes, I'd say. Michelle's alternate costume gives me a Lara Croft vibe, but with added zebra striped socks and elbow pads. I like it more than a default costume. June's, I feel, fits her more than her default, which is why I guess it's what she wears in the promotional art and FMVs. It's simple and to the point, which fits someone like her. Still not my favourite costume of hers, though. Lay's alternate costume is another series regular. It's what we see him wear when he's doing his police work. He also has shorter hair. Like many other costumes, it's fine, but later games will improve this idea. Now to beat the game again with this lot and see their newly added endings. Heihachi has defeated Kazuya, and determined to escalate their father-son cliff-dropping dick-measuring contest, he decides to drop Kazuya into an active volcano, that later erupts as Heihachi leaves by helicopter. This is not just canon, it's also hilarious. Paul rides his motorbike down a mountain road only for a landslide to block his path. After his ending last game had him punch through a brick wall, he decides punching through a massive boulder is the next step. Law has brought a very ugly waxwork of Paul to his dojo, where he shows off a sick flip. Paul makes the most unforgivable face a human could make and tries the same, but fails. Law shrugs. Jack 2 plays with Jane. However, a satellite out in space, run by Dr. Boskonovich's rival, Dr. Abel, fires a laser down at Jack 2 and destroys him in front of Jane, setting up the story of the Jack series for the next few games. Nina visits her father's grave to place flowers. She turns and draws her gun for Anna to be behind her. Anna isn't there to fight, she's also there to place flowers at their dad's grave. Nina lets things be and walks away, even smiling. Enjoy that one moment of peace between those two, it's the last one you'll ever get. King watches the live-action kids through his orphanage window, leaving Christmas presents for them outside and walking away. But the kids run out and crowd around him like in his Tekken 1 ending. Why couldn't that coat have been one of his costumes? Yoshimitsu jumps into the helicopter containing Dr. Boskonovich and frees him. He jumps out with him as the helicopter explodes. enjoy that last look at Yoshimitsu's skin because it's the last you'll ever see. Michelle takes a walk by a lake, looking at the pendant that has caused her family so much trouble. She throws it in the lake to be free of it. June takes a bus deep into nature to reconnect with it. She then gets surrounded by animals like a Disney princess and rides a horse off into the sunset. Lei unloads a million bullets practicing in the shooting gallery. It turns out he shot the end into a target. That's all, time for those sub-bosses. Lee's alternate is a bit of a letdown. Instead of the suit he had last time, he has the skinniest leather vest imaginable. His model doesn't help either. If you remove the life bars and let your eyes unfocus, you could easily mistake him for Tekken 3 Brian. Later games will merge his two costumes in this one into something better. Kuma is a polar bear with red claws now. That's all, I'm fine with it. Peck dresses casually for his alternate costume. It's a little like Lee's, but I think it works better on Peck. I prefer his default though. Prototype Jack just gets a blue palette swap. I like it, looks cool on him. Anna also gets a blue palette swap, but I always felt the red suited her much better. And Armakin gets a blue palette swap too. It works, but I think P-Jack still wins on blue palette swaps. Kunimitsu's purples become orange and brown. I don't care for it. Ganyu's Mawashi turns red and he gets a tan. It's a shame he only got a palette swap when the first game gave him an entirely new second outfit. Wang just gets a red palette swap. I prefer the blue, but it's still better than his Tekken 1 look. Bruce wears a shorter pair of shorts with his name printed on. He also swaps his wraps for boxing gloves and slightly changes his hairstyle. I think I prefer his primary. Roger and Alex don't get alternate costumes since Alex is the alternate costume. They are unlocked through the same method to fighting them in the arcade version, winning with a great on stage 3. You don't have to beat them to unlock them, just triggering the fight will let you play as them. This time, the unlockable characters all get their own endings. Lee becomes the new CEO of the Mishima Zaibatsu and has Heihachi and Kazuya jailed. He's very happy. Kuma gets a parody of Paul's Tekken 1 ending, breaking through glass, breaking glass as Heihachi falls into the air, and knocking through a brick wall with Paul's picture on it. Peck looks at the picture in his locket of him and his dad. He remembers his good memories with his dad and makes peace with himself over causing his death. Prototype Jack tries a bit of flying, but a few of his screws come loose and we hear him explode. Anna has a shower. When she gets out, Nina takes a photo to humiliate her. Violent sibling feud or not, that's not normal, Nina. No one should be making that face over running a naked photo of their sister. What's the matter with you? We see x-rays of Armaking's chest and an EKG waveform as he sits in his locker room. As he heads for the ring, his vision blurs and he bleeds from his eye, before he heads into the ring to the cheers of his fans. This one sort of maybe goes somewhere, but it's unclear if this ending has anything to do with Armaking's future. Kunimitsu has Yoshimitsu's sword, fulfilling her grandfather's wish. She tests it out on a tree, getting one last attack in before Namco benches her from canon for being too old, unlike that young lad Heihachi. Garyu stands in the middle of his new sumo ring, having finally obtained the money to build his own. That's all. Wang visits Jinpachi Mishima's grave to douse it in booze before taking a drink himself. It's a good thing Jinpachi's body isn't actually buried on that cliff edge. Given how big he turns out to be, I doubt a cliff edge could contain him. A kid tries peering through Bruce's window to watch him practice, so Bruce puts on a shirt for the kid and gives him a thumbs up through the window. Roger goes running with a herd of regular kangaroos. Alex sees an actual dinosaur fossil and from observing it learns to change his posture to actually run like a dinosaur. Kazuya is unlocked by clearing arcade mode as a sub-boss, but only after you've cleared the game as all the default 10. This one threw me as a kid. I first beat the game as Jack 2 and unlocked Prototype Jack. Then I beat the game as Prototype Jack and unlocked Nobody. So I assumed beating the game as the unlockables was pointless. But when I did finish the game as the original 10, I saw there were two empty character slots for Kazuya and Devil and I had no idea what to do. So I gave up hope on unlocking them until one day I just went through as Kuma on a whim and unlocked him. Kazuya's alternate outfit is probably his weirdest one, for him anyway. An unbuttoned jacket with a mesh shirt and metal boots. It's not bad, it's more interesting than his original alternate outfit, but I'm just not sure if it fits him. I couldn't imagine him going about his day wearing this. But then again, this is a guy who collects sneakers and I still can't imagine him doing that either. I should also add that on PS1 you can play as his best purple suit costume by selecting him with the start button, but only after every character is unlocked.
KO.
Kazuya defeats the devil within himself, but Devil turns out to be alive. He gets up and fires a laser at Kazuya, only for Heihachi, in the only show of affection towards his son in the series, takes the blow. Kazuya is grateful for the meat shield as he grabs Heihachi and uses him to block Devil's further lasers as he runs in. He distracts Devil by throwing Heihachi at him and takes him out with an uppercut, delivering another smug grin. Finishing the game as Kazuya finally unlocks Devil and Angel. The only thing to bring up is that Angel now has her own name and her own voice clips. They have no extra costumes, so let's just get this done. Devil fires a laser at the top of this building to create a huge explosion. He then flies to the moon. Angel sits on a skyscraper and jumps off. She thinks of a default cast, then surrounds Devil by skeleton angels, presumably destroying him. And there was Tekken 2. I do think the rest of the series surpasses this game, but I still think it holds up. Thing is, the original Tekken was too slow and clunky to be fun. This game retains a bit of clunk, but it's fast enough to be enjoyed, and I think that's important, because there are people who could be overwhelmed by the speed of the games after this. I think Tekken 2 is the best place to start the series if you're new to fighting games. It's fast and responsive enough to be enjoyed, but not so much that it might be hard to get into. Although, if someone does decide to start with this game, if they're playing the arcade version, I'd recommend playing with a friend instead of the AI. On PS1 you'll be fine though. But apart from the gameplay, we have a much bigger cast and a better soundtrack. It really does render the first game obsolete. That's all for the game, but as you saw earlier, I finally passed 100 games 100%ed in this show. Now of course there's the asterisk that it's not 100 unique games, as some games I've played more than one version. But they still count, because I still spent the time and effort playing and recording those games and talking about them. It may look like I saved not just a game I like, but a sequel to a game I played earlier on and a game that's generally well liked for my 100th game, but this was just a pure coincidence. I'm not into planning every 100 games to end on something special, because I don't want to elevate games over others based on their popularity or iconicness. There's a reason my first episode has two iconic games of their era separated by the Super Spy. It's why Dragon Quest was part of the same episode as Master of Darkness. It's why last episode had two popular 16-bit JRPGs sharing time with an obscure PS2 game no one's heard of and a licensed anime card game. I want to treat all games equally apart from their final rankings. It's why a game I like, such as Super Mario Bros., has a video less than a third the length of the game I didn't, like 40 Winks. Games get as long as I have things to talk about, and I will give them every bit of attention I can, regardless of my feelings or the status of the game. And if I just did all the big, popular, iconic games, sure I could have more than 17 subscribers after 2.5 years of uploading these videos, but I'd run out pretty quick. It's why in 100 games, I've only covered 5 Mario games, 3 Sonic games, and 1 Zelda. I really try to avoid trend chasing, which is why I set the rule that I won't cover any game that's less than a year old. But explaining my thought processes aside, I'm glad I at least took it out this far. There are moments where my incredibly low viewership has made me consider giving up. It can be demoralising when every time a video gets more views than usual, it's always because I get an influx of bot views and comments. My Soul Blade video is the only one to break 100 views as of now, and that is clearly 90% bots. But I admit, I have been deliberately avoiding things that help out a channel out of a dislike for those things. I have never asked for the viewer to subscribe in a video, nor will I put myself making a stupid gurning face in the thumbnail. I understand these things work, and no one actually likes doing these things, but I'm sticking with that choice on principle. But don't mistake this as me whining about no one watching, or that I'm planning on stopping anytime soon. I still have at least 20 more games recorded as I write this on November 27th, 2021, with many more I want to get started on. And I'm genuinely glad that there are still people who watch these, I just wish the bots weren't getting my hopes up.